I'd like to tell you why I believe that the UK Independence Party, over the course of the next 152 days, is about to take Wales by storm.
Good.
Yeah. But our success in making history over the next 6 months is dependent on us meeting certain challenges. We've certainly made inroads, and in a moment I'm going to tell you about what I've discovered since I've opened my shop, but I won't pretend that there's still a lot of work to do, and that's what I'd like to discuss now. But before I begin, I want to tell you a little bit about my background and why I got involved. It shocks some people to know that I've never voted before in a general election. I'm going to explain why. You know, when I was growing up, I came to the position that my own views were fringe. They were marginal, that I was somehow unusual. And the reason for that is that in school and in media, I noticed that my own values and the views of my family were not reflected in the education system or in mainstream media. And so I went through a lot of my life growing up thinking that I was in a minority. But when I grew up and I started talking to real people who had jobs, who had to pay their mortgages, who had families to raise, what I came to discover was that in Britain there is a silent majority. And this silent majority is not represented in our mainstream political parties and in the press. So the question occurred to me, why, if the vast majority of the British people share my values, the values of my parents, the values of my grandparents, why are they not represented in mainstream media and in mainstream politics? And the conclusion that I came to was that this silent majority have no interest in going around trying to tell other people how to live, how to think, how to live their lives. They're only interested in working hard, raising their families, paying off their mortgages, and looking forward to their retirement. Now, unfortunately, the kind of people who are attracted to positions of power and influence are those kind of people who think that they have an obligation to go around telling other people what to do. And that is why we've got a political elite that is entirely out of touch with the people in this country and that does not represent our views, our interests, and our values. And in fact, if I could be perfectly frank with you, I would describe myself as somewhat a reluctant politician. And in fact, some of the new candidates that are coming through, like Andrew over there, hopefully, Sam, who spoke to you earlier, all we'd really like to be able to do is crack on with making a living and looking after our families. But what we're growing to realize is that if we don't get involved, our families, when they grow up, are not going to be able to live in this country. So it's essential that men and women who don't want to go around telling other people what to do and imposing their belief systems and their values on other people, make an exception and get involved. Now, as you've already heard, a week ago, I responded to the command of our fearless leader, and I parked a tank on neighbour's front lawn. And since that day, I've learned quite a lot. I've had the privilege of speaking to many people in my constituency, both those who support us, but also those who are on the fence and who don't support us. And I think I've got a short list of some of the issues which I believe that if we can address succinctly in very few words, we will convince an overwhelming majority of people in our respective constituencies to switch sides and vote for us, and you'll see exponential growth as we move towards May of next year. So I'd like to very quickly summarise these issues for you. Now, many of them have already been covered, but I think it's quite helpful to have them all together in one go. Now, a lot of people come into my shop, and there's been a constant stream of people over the last few days since I opened my campaign cafe. I'll just tell you a little bit about the concept. The idea is that in contrast with what may be a traditional campaign shop where people come in, they stand around, they wait for their opportunity to talk to somebody, my concept was to have a campaign cafe. So people could come in, they could relax, they could have a cup of coffee, something to eat, and then they could discuss things that were important to them and close to their heart without feeling that they had to discuss some monumental issue with us. So I think that this kind of system that we've developed in my constituency gives us a tremendous insight into what's in people's minds and what they're concerned about. I'm very pleased to say that the vast majority of people who have come into my shop and said that they want to talk about what we represent and have initially said that they have no intention of voting for UKIP have gone out of that door pledging their support to UKIP. But having said that, there are six issues which I've identified that I think we all need to be very au fait, very fluent in dealing with in order to gain votes. The first one is the economy. Now, many people say that in principle, they respect what we stand for, they share many of our views and our values, but they don't trust us to run the economy. Okay. And in response to that, what I tell them is that I honestly would have more confidence in my seven-year-old son running the British economy than in the last few governments. And the reason is that by the age of seven, my son has already learnt the principle that you don't spend money that you don't have. And if you argue that that's just rhetoric, with just six strokes of a pen, UKIP is capable of shaving off 62% of the current government deficit. And very, very briefly, leaving the EU, we save 8 million. Cutting foreign aid by 85%, we save 9 million. Destroying two unnecessary government departments is a further 2.9 million. Stopping NHS tourism is a further 2 million. I think we're on 22 million there already. Sorry. Billion. We're on 22 billion already. And now there's another 45 billion which nobody seems to have discussed. Now, yesterday I spoke to an economist and he assures me that if we implement this turnover tax on foreign corporations, to the extent that we create an economic environment in which international corporations that essentially keep their profits offshore are able to compete on an equal footing with domestic corporations, we will gain £45 billion in taxes. There we go. You add the 45 to the 22, you get 67. That's 62% of the current £108 billion deficit in this country. And that's before we even start talking about how, once we're loose of the shackles of the European Union, our businesses are going to thrive, they're going to grow, they're no longer going to be frightened to employ workers. Okay, but time is short, so I'll move on to the next thing, and that is the European Union. There's a very strange perception amongst some people that we need the European Union. And I've asked people, why do you perceive that we need the European Union? What is our benefit? And, you know, they say things like, well, if we didn't have the European Union, our mothers wouldn't have maternity leave, or our workers wouldn't be able to work in safety. And, you know, what that actually tells me is that it betrays an extraordinary modesty on the part of the British people that they believe that 28 unelected, unaccountable, anti-democratic commissioners who don't care a jot about what goes on in this country are better capable of working out what is fair for our people in this country than we are, we who love our country and love our fellow people in this country. In fact, one lady who came into my shop about 3 days ago put it really well. And she said, she came in a non-UKIP voter, she walked out a UKIP voter, and she acknowledged, with respect to the way the European Union works, that Germany makes the rules, France ignores the rules, and Britain obeys the rules. Yeah. And you know, I'll illustrate that very, very briefly with some evidence. I've got a house in Bulgaria, okay? My family have spent some time there. The Bulgarians are lovely people, and I don't blame them for a moment coming here earning about five times as much. I would actually disagree with that 250%, because I employ about 20 of them. And my workers get paid more than anyone else pays in that area. That's why they come and work for me. And I pay them about £12 a day for unskilled labour. And that's a good wage in the place where I am. And I would be very surprised if an unskilled labourer couldn't make 60 quid a day in the UK. But anyway, that's by the by. What happens in Bulgaria with European Union funding? I'll give you an example of it. In a village called Razgrad, close to where I live, a man has applied for a 2 million euro EU grant, and he's been awarded it, and he's built a hotel. It's a fantastic hotel. I think it's got about 50 rooms. Now, the purpose of this EU grant was to promote tourism to this area and to create local jobs, all sorts of very nice things. Now, I've been to this hotel about six times, and never on one occasion have I ever seen a paying client. So essentially, what's happened is this recipient of this grant has created a stately home for himself and his family. And whenever I've been there, I've just seen this family drinking rakia and having barbecues and not making any money or employing any jobs. You see, there's a fallacy that Europe is all about equalizing wealth across the European Union and creating jobs. But what actually happens is that a very small clique of people who are well connected get access to these funds, and these £55 million a day that we are spending are worse than wasted. They're actually promoting further inequality throughout Europe. So, sorry, I know I'm over time, but I just want to very, very briefly touch on a couple of other things. Something else, which is a genuine concern that some people have about UKIP, is that we're little Englanders. And I think what they mean by that is that we don't care about what's going on in the rest of the world. We're only bothered about what's going on in the UK, and we're largely ignorant about the opportunities that exist between us and other countries. What I think it's really important to get across to these people is that our membership of the European Union actually makes us something worse, which is little Europeans. Okay. If we leave the European Union, we will have the opportunity to develop trade relationships with developing countries. And to my mind, that's rather like getting in when a company goes public on its IPO. There are developing countries which are growing so fast, and that's where we stand to make huge gains. If we wait for Europe to spend 10 years negotiating trade agreements with these countries, we're going to miss the boat. Okay. Finally, we need to deal with the issue of trust. A lot of people coming into our shop say that we're just like other politicians. They don't trust us. They know we're saying something different, but if we get in, we're going to betray the people, just like the main political class. We're going to lie. We're not going to keep our word. Now, I know we've got this policy of recall, and it's very important that people understand that, so that if 20% of people in any given constituency believe that a candidate has lied and got there under false pretenses, they can trigger a by-election and boot him out. But I think, as Sam was saying earlier, words are not enough. We've got to show that we're different. We're not like the mainstream political class. And the best way that we can show that is in our response to protesters and people who are angry about us. If we welcome them in and we appeal to their hearts and to their minds, we'll surprise them and they'll go away trying to convince their friends that we are different and at least to give us a chance. And I've seen that over the course of the last week. A couple of nights ago, a young man burst into a meeting. He called me a fascist. I can't tell you what the second word was. And I asked him why he thought we were fascist. He gave me a few reasons, and I explained to him very gently He came round, he stayed for about an hour, we shook hands and he left friends. And all of his friends on the outside who had been looking in through the window to see this supposed conflict develop, Sam went out and shook their hands and were friends with all of them, because we understand that although they have misplaced logic, they're sincere people who also care about this country. And if we just run roughshod over their concerns and don't appeal to their hearts and minds, we're not going to be perceived as any different to any other political party. I really will close now. Now, I've done the maths on this, and there are about 3 million people in Wales, as we know, and if each of us speaks to just one person in an honest, straightforward, relaxed way every week, and we convince that person to speak honestly about what UKIP really stands for every week, then by the end of March, we can have reached 3 million people face to face. And finally, I would just ask, please have a look at what's going on social media and in the news. When a story comes out, it has a tremendous impact if UKIP supporters can go online and can comment positively and honestly and raise really sincere questions to provoke these people to think, because we're so close. And if we pass that tipping point and we shed all of this misrepresentation and we answer all of these legitimate concerns about what we stand for, I strongly believe that we are going to totally surprise all expectations come May of next year, get our country back, return democracy to this place, and genuinely make Wales the best place to live in Europe. Thank you very much.